Good evening, George Orwell. Perhaps we should start with you telling us a little about yourself.
I like English cookery, English beer, French red wine, Spanish white wine, Indian tea, strong tobacco, coal fire, candlelight, and comfortable chairs.
Go on.
I dislike big towns, noise, the motor car, the radio, tinned food, and central heating.
Interestingly...
And modern furniture.
Quite.
Famous for writing 1984 and inventing Big Brother, George Orwell witnessed and reported on some of the defining moments of the 20th century. But there are no moving pictures of Orwell, nor are there any recordings of his voice. He did leave a vast written legacy, containing insights on everything from diet to revolution. It's this we used to create his life in pictures. The pictures are invented, but every statement Orwell utters is his own. In an early documentary, Orwell is an imperial policeman. In a film essay, he's a kitchen hand.
Roughly speaking, the more one is obliged to pay for food, the more sweat and spittle one is obliged to eat with it.
In Newsreel, he's glimpsed as a freedom fighter.
The perfect cup of tea. My own rules, every one of which I regard as golden.
And war reporter.
And enormous piles of rubble, out of which iron girders thrust themselves like sticks of rhubarb.
Towards the end of his career, he penned the confessional essay, Why I Write.
All writers are vain, selfish, and lazy. And at the bottom of their motives, there lies a mystery.
And so you have no control over what you write.
Writing a book is a horrible, exhausting struggle, like a long bout with some painful illness. One would never undertake such a thing if one were not driven by some demon one can neither resist nor fully comprehend.
1984, with its thought police, Room 101 and Big Brother, has given us a language with which we can defy oppression. What demon drove you to dream up 1984?
I do not think one can assess a writer's motives without knowing something of his early development. His subject matter will be determined by the age in which he lives. But before he ever begins to write, he will have acquired an emotional attitude from which he will never completely escape.
George Orwell's real name was Eric Blair. He was born on the 25th of June, 1903, into what he labelled the lower upper middle class. This mock Tudor villa in the Thames Valley was the Blair family home. He was only 8 when he was sent away to boarding school.
It is not easy for me to think about my school days without seeming to breathe a whiff of something cold and evil smelling.
Such were the joys when we all girls and boys.
Such were the joys was an autobiographical essay on Blair's school days. Considered libelous, it wasn't published in his lifetime. But as this expressionist film adaptation shows, it is crucial to understanding his character.
Soon after I arrived, I began to wet the bed, a disgusting crime. Night after night, I prayed with a fervor never previously attained in my prayers. Please, God, do not let me wet the bed. Oh, please, God, do not let me wet the bed. But it made remarkably little difference. The grim, statuesque matron, Daphne by name, arrived in the dormitory especially to inspect my bed. She pulled back the sheets, then drew herself up, and the dreaded words seemed to come rolling out of her like a peal of thunder. Report yourself to the headmaster after breakfast. He knew, of course, why I had been sent to him, and had already taken a bone-handled riding crop out of the cupboard. He read me a short but pompous lecture